experience. We don't have to look like a bunch of wankers. We can go on there and not be compromised. And then came the sort of the Rock Awards time, and it was just like the writing was on the wall. The band were going to scoop everything. Everybody knew it. It was like, oh, shit, here we go. What do you do about this? You're damned if you do, if you're damned if you don't.
We knew that we were going to clean up these awards, and we thought it was just a good point, you know, it's a place to make a stand and just let them know that, you know, hey, where were you? You know, it's okay for you old guys going, here's your awards, we love this band, when 4 years earlier, we couldn't get on the show if we wanted to, you know, we couldn't get on Countdown 2 years earlier, you know, and if we did, it was pushed around and bossed around like a bunch of kids by these people who knew nothing about what we were doing. So we did My Turn to Cry, which is one of my songs, we snuck in a rehearsal room, and we changed it slightly, you know, to change the breakdown in the middle. We changed it and went in another song, which was said, you know, where were you when we were struggling? Where were you when we were in the Larkspur Hotel? You know, where were you when we were starving to death, you know? And now you want to use it to sell TV weeks up yours, well, eat this, you know. But at the same time, although that was quite serious, it was virtually, you know, just a laugh. We were like kids, no kid, we finished that, and we ran out the back, straight out the back door, and we're just cacking ourselves into the car and left. And we threw up our own party down the road. We boycotted the Countdown party, and I think everybody came to our party. And in the end, even Molly came over to our party, we threw him out.
Funny now, everybody talks about this as being this great moment in Australian rock history. But I can tell you that, you know, the industry people are saying, you know, you guys are fucked, you've just killed your career. And, you know, Molly was trying to crucify us in the newspapers and everybody, and, you know, freaking out about the whole thing. And, of course, nowadays, everybody talks about it like, oh, wow, did you see that time when Chisel broke up all their equipment? You know, like, hell. You know, people were just ashen-faced over the whole thing.
Cold Chisel would go on to have 4 number one albums, become one of the all-time great rock bands, and have a bunch of songs that many would consider national anthems. Yet after only 6 years as a signed act, the band was soon to break up.
There's a lot of things that went down in that second tour that really should never have gone down.
We should have done better with what we had.
Whatever happens, I don't want to dwell. I don't want to wait 2 years. I want to make a solo record. I don't want to do it right now.
Although Cold Chisel had almost become a cult in Australia, international success still eluded them. America in particular provided too many hurdles for the band to overcome.
When we came back from America, we'd just been through 2 or 3 years of rapid acceleration. We had gone from support spots to being the biggest band in the country, where every month you could see it getting bigger, wider, the band getting bigger, the audience getting bigger, everything just steamrolling into areas that no band had got to culturally in this country before. You know, we were kind of more than a band by that stage. And going to America was the first time when there was kind of a speed bump.
By the time we got to America, the music scene had changed that much. It was very, you know, the West Coast, LA, you know, it was all, I've said it before, it was all about sort of big cars and models and cocaine and not about music and not about feel and not about soul. And, you know, we'd sort of missed this whole period.
And instead of every 6 months seeing us in new places that, as far as what we were doing, that we never dreamed we could reach, suddenly we're in the same place again, going around again, making an album here again for Australia, instead of having gone on to bigger and better.
We were like sort of wild colonials to them, you know. They didn't know how to deal with us because the band was still the same, still fiery and wild, and, you know, much rather, you know, drink and fight than sort of schmarm and schmooze. First time we came in the office, we're walking in, and they must have got G'd up that we were coming. And they're like, there's these guys jumping out. Hey, love your single. Yeah, yeah, love your record. Yeah, beautiful. Great to have you in our country, you know, and all this sort of stuff. And then they'd hide back in their offices again, you know. And we walked all the way along this corridor, and we went into this office of the guy who was the national promotions manager for the record, who was doing all the promotions for Cold Chisel's record. And his name is Marty Schwartz. And we were doing one show and one show only in Los Angeles. And this was his chance to see us. And I said, oh, would you like to, you know, you're coming to the gig tonight. And he literally said, oh, I can't make it. I've got to go to a DJ's dog's birthday party. And we just looked at him. We wanted to kill him, you know. I wanted to jump his desk and throttle him. So we just got up, said, right, see ya. Got up and walked out of the office. So we went and did the gig in LA. And literally, the guy turned up. We came off stage and we were in our dressing room, and we just finished playing this gig. It was a pretty blitzkrieg gig. And, you know, sweating and drunk and everything, like, you know, just hammered. And this guy turns up, and Marty Schwartz, and he walks in the dressing room. And so I walked up and I said, did you see the gig? And he said, no, I just got here, you know. And I was, by this point, I was ready to thump him, you know. So he grabs me aside and he says, hey, come here. I said, you know, come here. And he says, you want some of this? And he pulls out this big bottle of cocaine, you know. And he's got me in the corner and he said, don't tell the others, you know, just keep it to yourself. And I said, give me that. And I grabbed it. And I walked out on the stage, and all these punters were still, like, so leaning on the front of the stage. And I just tipped it out on the front of the stage. I said, any of you guys do this shit? And I went back and I threw the bottle at them and then threw them out of the dressing room. And basically, that's, you know, that was the end of Cold Chisel with Electra.
I think he just took a genuine dislike to this guy because he saw through the guy that he was basically a wanker, you know.
Well, straight after that night, I went back to the hotel and we started writing the song, and I wrote the song, You Got Nothing I Want. Particularly for Marty Schwartz. When we finished it and recorded it, we sent it to him, which really was the final sort of nail in the coffin for Cold Chisel in America.
I always thought that that Cold Chisel at that time was the best band in the world. A lot of other people who saw them then agreed. And